enter into your courts, we pray. We enter into your gates with thanksgiving. Enter into your courts, we pray. We enter into your gates with thanksgiving. Enter into your courts, we pray. Enter into your gates with thanksgiving. Enter into your courts, we pray. Bless your holy name, oh God. We bless your holy name, Almighty God. Hallelujah. Courts, oh God, with praise. Oh, we delight in you, Lord. Delight in you. Enter into your gates with thanksgiving. Enter into your courts with praise. I enter into your gates with thanksgiving. Enter into your courts with praise. Enter into your gates with thanksgiving. Enter into your courts with praise. Enter into your gates with thanksgiving. Enter into your courts. Enter into your gates with thanksgiving. Enter into your courts with praise. Enter into your gates with thanksgiving. Enter into your courts with praise. Be all glory. Oh, unto the King eternal, unto the only true God, be our glory. Be our glory.
Unto the King eternal,
all glory. Unto the King eternal, unto the only true God be all glory, be all glory. Unto the only true God be all glory, be all glory. How I love you, because you first loved me. Be all glory, holy, 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 holy. Oh, all creation cries unto thee, unto the eternal God, unto the only true God. Be all glory. Glory and honor and power and might and dominion to your name forever, Lord Jesus. Glory and honor and power and might and dominion be unto you, Lord Jesus, forever and ever. Oh, glory and honor and power and dominion, oh, unto you, oh God, our King, unto the King eternal, unto the only true God be all glory, be all glory. Glory and honor and power and might and dominion unto you, Lord Jesus, forever and forever. Oh, glory and honor and power and dominion unto you, Lord Jesus, forever and forever, oh God. Be all glory. Mananda mana no shibrana mana namre de besti tara tara kasisur. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord. Almighty God, we praise you, Lord, eternal. We praise you, Lord, Almighty God. We praise you, Most High. We praise you, Lord, Almighty God. We praise you, Lord. Aquí. Hallelujah. I see the Lord is high and lifted up, his train, his glory fills his temple. I see the Lord is lifted up, his glorious train fills the temple. I see the Lord, his eyes lifted up, exalted above everything. I see the Lord, he's lifted up, his glory is exalted above everything. I see Jesus standing now. I see Jesus standing now at the right hand of the Father, just for me. I see Jesus standing now, and he's looking earnestly, and he's looking earnestly. I see Jesus standing now just for me. Oh, I see Jesus standing now. Oh, and he's looking earnestly. Oh, I see Jesus standing now as he intercedes. And I see Jesus standing now. Oh, and he's looking earnestly. I see Jesus standing now with his love for me. I see Jesus standing now, and he's looking earnestly, and he's looking earnestly. I see Jesus standing now in his love for me. Oh, glory and honor and power and might and dominion to Jesus Christ the Lord forever and ever. Oh, forever sing, oh, glory and honor and power and
Hallelujah!
Lord, we will worship you, Spirit and truth, in the Holy Ghost and truth. With the rushing might you win, and the closing times of fire. And I said, I'm on down till I die round. The clothing tongues of fire. Pentecost now, Pentecost in the lies forever. The great outpourings. Woohoo! Of the Holy Ghost and fire.
Hallelujah. If you're just visiting here this morning, we are dedicated to not following Christian tradition, but following what God set up in the order of his church when the church was born on the day of Pentecost and the Holy Ghost came. And he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's always doing the same thing. He baptized them all in the Holy Ghost. Holy Spirit baptized them in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Christ Jesus sent the Holy Ghost as the baptizer. And the Holy Ghost caused his glory to fall upon everyone that was there. And they all began to speak with other tongues, all of them. Not one by one, all of them. And then Paul describes it in 1 Corinthians 14 a little bit more as he's trying to help people understand a little bit of order to all of the flow of the Holy Ghost and the manifestation of signs and wonders and demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power, the miracles, the gifts of healing, the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, the gift of faith, prophecy, tongues, and interpretation in tongues. He tells them, now listen, what are we going to do then? He said, what we're going to do then is we're going to pray in the Spirit, and we're going to pray with the understanding also, Father, we thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost that you poured out upon us, that we can be your church to live out this wonderful realm of glory. We're going to sing in this. We're going to sing in the Spirit. And we're going to sing in the understanding also. Glory and honor and power and might and dominion unto you, Lord Jesus Christ, forever and forever. So that's what we're doing. Praise God for the hymn books that were written. You know, some of the first hymn books were written, they were, especially revival hymn books, they were written around John and Charles Wesley. Charles was a prolific songwriter because he had a moving of God, the Holy Ghost, in his life. And so, you know, at that period of time, most people prayed somebody else's prayers. And then they grew spiritually beyond praying someone else's prayers, reading them off the page. And then they started praying their own prayers. And then the church started singing someone else's songs. And there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that. But you're supposed to also sing a new song, too. You're supposed to sing by the Spirit. I know you've been trained to do these things, and that's why people are perplexed when they come in this place, because we're not going to do the religious thing. We're just not going to do it. We're going to let God the Holy Ghost have the leadership and the control that he wants to have. And it may not be happening to the full scale of it, but I'm going to guarantee you, the Lord is going to see us, and he's going to see the leadership of this ministry with a consecration to letting him take control and not do it our way, but do it his way. Listen, I've dealt with the pressures for all of my life. My dad's a minister revivalist, so I've done this all my life. So we know what we're doing. Follow us. We've been pastoring for 36 years. We can do this, okay? And we can find ourselves being conformed to the image of Christ and doing things God's way according to his word rather than human tradition, religious tradition. And, you know, the Spirit of the Lord so wants to do some rich and wonderful things in our lives. But we've got to be willing to move forward with them. The scripture is way in the future. It's way advanced beyond us. And if we'll start doing it, we'll be with right where God is and functioning in his wisdom. And, you know, then what happened was, back to my story, then the church, you know, started basically singing out of a hymn book someone else's songs when this person or that person was anointed of God and wrote a wonderful song. You know, like, take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. You know, wonderful songs that were written over the centuries. And, you know, it went then from that point to where that the hymnals became out of, as it were, style. And everybody started then doing their songs off of the brochures. Still, during the latter rain revival, the Holy Spirit would, you know, be allowed every once in a while in different meetings the privilege to move in the way that he wanted to move. And my mother, who was one of the great Pentecostal churches in America in the 30s and the 40s, she'd say everybody would begin to sing and begin to worship. I'm talking about hundreds and hundreds of people begin to sing and begin to worship a song that had never been sung before, all at the same time, as though there was a choir conductor doing the meeting himself, and they had all rehearsed the song. And then all of a sudden, you know, we really got advanced, and we started doing music by overhead. And try to put a hymn book in the hand of somebody who's been singing by overhead. They're going to look strange at it. Imagine somebody who's spent their life now singing in the Spirit and a new song being birthed out of that. I'm singing with the understanding and trying to put them on overhead. We want you to experience and taste and see what God has for you. Somebody said, oh, then we can't do everything together. Oh, we could do everything together. The Holy Ghost has come for the single purpose of you and I doing everything together. In fact, Father's not even going to take any worship that's not lit on fire by the Holy Ghost. It's got to be God-breathed through you and me. Otherwise, it's nothing more than religion. Christianity becomes nothing more than Hinduism or Buddhism or any other ism. It's just a religion. Just a religion. Christ Jesus did not die for us to have religion. He died for us to come into this wonderful realm of oneness and unity with him, to be made a new creation, to be led by the Holy Ghost, moved by the Spirit of truth, to be real with him. I want to sing a song that was written by Pastor Elijah Adeboye. This is a good one now. Pastor Elijah Adeboye, his church is 1.8 miles by 1.8 miles. 1.8 miles long and 1.8 miles wide. About 1 million people together. And so we're going to sing this song. I took the liberty to add a verse or two to it because I got it from the same source he did.
You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. who was and is and is to come. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, you are exalted in the heavens. You are high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You are exalted in the heavens. You are high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the Alpha and beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are exalted. You are exalted in the heavens. You are high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You are exalted in the heavens. You are high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. Jesus. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. Hallelujah. Just lift your voice. Maybe you don't know the language of the Spirit. You can just hum. Just hum your way to heaven. Or just sing in the Spirit too, with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Hallelujah. Osamade kosabrabo kisareve primani. Hallelujah. We worship you all. worship you. We worship you by the Holy Ghost. We worship you, Lord Jesus. We worship you in spirit and in truth. We honor and adore you, Father. We come by your only begotten Son. We come by your only begotten Son. We worship you, Father. We worship you, Heavenly Father. We worship you in spirit. We worship you in spirit and truth. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Almighty God, we worship you. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Almighty God, we worship you.
Do that song. We are the people of God.
We are the people of God, and He is our Lord. Oh, we are the people of God, and He is our Lord. Oh, we are the people of God, and He is our Lord. Oh, we are the people of God. We are the people of God, and He is our Lord. Oh, we are the people of God, and He is our Lord. Oh, we are the people of God, and He is our Lord.
Your presence is like fire, it's like water.
And He is our Lord. Oh, and we are your people, oh God, and you are our Lord. Oh, we are your people, oh God, and you are our Lord. Oh, we are your people, oh God, and you are our Lord. Oh, we are your people, oh God, and you are our Lord. Your presence is like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain. Oh, your presence is like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain. Oh, your presence is like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain. So sweet, waters, like the floods of rain on your presence. It's like a fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain on your presence. It's like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain on your presence. It's like fire, it's like water.
Thank you for your son. Oh God, we thank you for your son. Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, we worship you. We worship and adore you. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. Let your glory now flood every soul. Oh God, let your glory now flood every life. Oh God, let your glory now fill everyone in this place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Why don't you just begin to pray? You can pray with your understanding. Some people just want to do that. They don't want to pray in the Spirit. So why don't you just pray? Why don't you just begin to pray? And just put a little hum to it. Just begin to pray. Because really worship is prayer set to music. Just begin to pray. Pray and pray, which is nothing more than really just praise and thanksgiving. Tell Father how wonderful He is to you. How glorious He is. How good He's been to you. Thank Him for all of His blessings. Thank Him for the breath of life. Thank Him that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Thank Him that your sins has been washed away by the precious blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, I thank You that You washed away my sins, cleansed me whiter than snow. See how easy it is? You'll be a songwriter before you leave. Hallelujah. Cleanse my life, You wash me whiter than snow. Your blood has cleansed me clean. Hallelujah. Thank You, Lord. You wrote my name in the book of life. You washed my sins away. You filled me with Your glory. You filled me with Your glory. You put Your Spirit in me. Oh God, and I'm so thankful. Oh God, and I'm so grateful. Oh God, and I'm so thankful. Oh God, I worship You. Oh Lord, and I'm so thankful. Oh Lord, and I'm so grateful. Oh God, I am so thankful. And Lord, I worship You. Here's another one, make it real easy for you. Because you're not going to have me on Monday, and I want people to be saved on Monday. I want people to be saved on Monday and full of the Holy Ghost and live out the life that God has purposed for us to live. He called us to live out our lives in praise and thanksgiving. Birds were made to fly, fish were made to swim, and we were made to praise. And some people let CDs do their praising for them. They let worship leaders do their praising for them. They let others do their praising. But I'm going to tell you right now, if you don't start praising Him, a rock's going to take your place. You can just say, Jesus, I love You. Jesus, You're my Redeemer. You're my Redeemer. Jesus, You're my Savior. You're my Savior. And I worship You. Oh Lord, Lord, I worship You. Hallelujah. Now you keep doing that, and I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. Prophecy will bust out of you. It will. You'll just be standing here in the meeting, and you'll just be going, oh, and Lord, I worship You. And your heart will be carried away by the Holy Ghost, and come busting out of you will be a thunderous display of thanksgiving right by the Holy Ghost, brought directly to you by the Spirit of the living God. And you go, what was that? And that's exactly what we want you to experience. That's what God wants you to experience. Because then the miracles start. Then the gift of faith starts. Then love all the time starts. Joy all the time starts. Peace all the time starts. The yell from hell goes away and the shout to the Lord begins. Strife is no longer a part of your life. Worry is no longer a part of your life. You're able to cast all your cares upon Him. Because you're living in a realm that is not normal and not natural anymore. It's one taught to us by God. Father brought to us this eternal life so that you and I could live out being the sons of God, the children of the Most High on this earth right now and live days of heaven right now. You may be living in the earth realm, but I'm not. I've been translated in the kingdom of the dear son. Some people waiting to die and go to heaven. I've entered into heaven. Because heaven and the Holy Ghost are absolutely the same. He doesn't go anywhere without displaying heaven. Jesus Christ, he's the King of heaven. He never leaves his realm. And right now, he is Lord of lords and kings of kings. He's not going to be Lord of lords and King of kings sometime in the future. He's not on a planet somewhere far out in the galaxies, in the unknown galaxies of the universe. He's right here, seated in the realms of divine power and glory. One day people's eyes are going to be open. They're going to see the throne of the Father, and they're going to see the Lamb sitting right beside of him. Jacob had the revelation. He was there in a vision, in a dream, and he saw angels ascending and descending. He saw a Father standing there and saying, I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac, commanding Jacob the things that he was supposed to do and the blessing that he had prescribed for him. And Jacob's revelation was, I've been in the house of God all this time. I did not know it. And that's not some little hill in Israel. In Ha'eretz Israel. Or the land of Israel. This is his earth. Amen. He reigns. There was a great king. His name was Nebuchadnezzar. And Nebuchadnezzar was the king of kings. He was over all of the realms of the world. And God likened him, his kingdom unto the greatest of kingdoms in a vision that was interpreted by Daniel. And one day God had purposed that Nebuchadnezzar would come to recognize who really rules in the kingdom of men. And so we read about it in Daniel chapter 4. Daniel went in and out and ate grass like an ox. He totally lost his mind. And one day he came to his senses and recognized it, that God rules in the kingdom of men. And I'm going to tell you right now, this revelation may not come to you yet. But Christ Jesus exalteth far above all principality and power and might and dominion. In every authority and every name that is named. Not only in this world, but also in the world to come. And he's reigning right now. And as Paul said in Colossians 1:13, we've been delivered out of the camp of darkness. We've been delivered out of the power of Satan and translated in the kingdom of his dear son. And we want you to get the revelation. We want your eyes to be open. The eyes of Elijah's servant was opened one day. It wasn't a special day where God decided to invade earth. He saw the reality of what's going on. His eyes were open. God wants to give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so God is not aloof to you anymore, but you can set him before you at your right hand that should not be moved. Then you can start moving in faith. Elisha's servant could not move in faith that day. Elisha had no problem. The Syrian army was encamped around about him to destroy him because he knew every secret that the king of Syria was saying in his bedroom. And so they were going to go get him and kill him so that somehow they could, you know, prosper in their attempt to overthrow Israel. They said, well, look, no, understand, you're going to have to kill this prophet because there's just no way that any secret of your heart is not going to be made known to him by the living God. And so his servant is with him and he's saying, there's tens of thousands of guys out here that are going to kill us. And Elisha says, no problem, we're good. And then the servant's looking at him going, what is this man crazy? What's going on here? How can we be good? There's only two of us and so many of them. He says, Lord, open up his eyes so he can see what the rest of us see who receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you. So he can see what the rest of us see who walk in the spirit, who mind spiritual things, who live in the spiritual realm. Hallelujah. Which is a heavenly realm. We make it something else in the semantics of the human language. We make spiritual something other than it is. Spiritual is just living and dwelling and walking in the Holy Ghost. Dear people, listen to me. You struggle with these things. Only God in his mercy can open your eyes. Only God in his mercy can open your eyes, and he wants to. But he waits to see somebody who's got a real hungry heart. And suddenly the servant of Elisha's eyes were opened up. And you know what he saw? He saw that everywhere around him, he saw the angels of the Lord, innumerable in number they are. He saw the horsemen of the Lord. He saw a different kind of horse and a different kind of chariot. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Suddenly his faith went to an all-time new high. He's like, he wasn't trying to believe anymore. He's like, he can see. He can see into the realms of the spiritual. See, the Lord has come to cause your eyes to see what is humanly impossible for them to see. Cause your ears to hear what is humanly impossible for them to hear. Cause your heart to understand what is humanly impossible for you to understand. This is a knowledge that goes beyond the perception and the understanding of men. And he's brought these things to us by the Holy Spirit. He brought these things into our life by the Holy Ghost. That which eye has not seen, which ear has not heard, neither has it entered into the heart of men, those things that God has prepared for those who love him. But the Spirit of truth, the Holy Ghost, has come to reveal them, to come make them known. Hallelujah. Try not to get too excited about it. No. I help you understand. You can be seated. You know, it isn't that, you know, Pentecostal people, they just need to be excited all the time. No, we just got a revelation. We got a revelation that the more excited you are about the things of God, the more you're going to be open and available to receive what God has to give. Every manifestation of the gift of the Spirit is right here, right now. All that you have need of, physically, spiritually, financially, materially, it's here right now. Because Christ Jesus is in the midst of his church. And it doesn't matter about how many people are there. All there needs to be is two or three. The reality of it is he's placed these gifts in his church. His church functions off of apostles and prophets, off of teachers, off of miracles and gifts of healing and governments and helps and also tongues and interpretation of tongues. People say, I don't like tongues and interpretation of tongues. Just give me the simple prophecy mode. No. No, we're not doing that anymore because this is the new covenant. It's not the old covenant. Somebody told me one time, the prophets and the men of God in the Old Testament, you know, they didn't need to be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire with the evidence of speaking in tongues to do signs and wonders and miracles. I said, time out. It's a new covenant. I know you didn't get the memo. Somehow it slipped by. The old covenant is gone, and all of the spiritual laws associated with the old covenant is gone. The new covenant has come. Jesus poured it out for us in his own blood and allowed you and me, street bums, to be able to come in. Oh, yeah, because the children were invited to the wedding and they didn't come. They were busy. One had to take care of his land, other had to take care of this, other had to take care of that. And the Lord said, no, go out in the highways and the byways and get all the street guys and bring them in so that my house may be full. And he gave us a wedding garment. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you right now, and he's done even more than that. When he redeemed us, he filled us with his Holy Spirit. He gave us a new nature. We become a new creation. And I'm just going to talk to you a little bit about this because it will totally blow you out of the water. Nicodemus comes to the Lord Jesus Christ and he says, Rabbi, we recognize that you are a teacher sent from God. We. He's the representative of his group. We represents group. He comes, we recognize that you were a teacher. He's the expert, right? Here comes the expert. Right? He doesn't know who he's talking to, but nonetheless, he's got a little bit of a hungry heart because he hears. The hungry heart will cause you to hear the sound of the wind. The hungry heart will cause you to hear the voice of the Spirit. So he says, we recognize that you, a teacher, come from God, sent from God. For no man could do these miracles that you do, lest God be with him. See, he's hearing and he's feeling the sound of the wind. Now, Jesus is going to turn his whole world upside down and he's going to make the righteousness by the law and Judaism completely irrelevant. It's going to turn his world upside down. Because Nicodemus, along with anyone else, you could read about different men of that age. One person that is known in rabbinic tradition is Rabbi Simeon or Gamaliel, which is also mentioned in the New Testament, whom Paul sat at Gamaliel's feet. What they said in their writings, they're still available to read right now. And so the kingdom of God was a common subject. And they would talk about the kingdom of God, how you could come into the kingdom of God, how you would be privileged and worthy to be able to sit down at the table, not of David, not with King David, not in the court of an earthly kingdom, but to sit down with Almighty God in the court of heaven. Hallelujah. And so righteousness, keeping the righteousness of the law and various different mitzvah, you know, mitzvah being good deeds, you know, and all these various different things that they would teach on how you're going to get to be a part of the kingdom of God. Jesus steps in and goes and starts telling him, you don't know anything about the kingdom of God. You can't see the kingdom of God. You can't understand the kingdom of God until you're born again. He has made every religion, including the most important and prominent and meaningful religion, Judaism, irrelevant. He made it irrelevant. said, you must be born again. You must be born of the Spirit and of the water. And of course, you know, Nicodemus didn't agree, and he's confused. He said, what are you talking about? He said, how can you, he reproves him now, how can you be a teacher, a leader in Israel and not know these things? Because you start going through the scripture and you'll find out over and again where Father pours out his water upon the dry ground, it becomes a fruitful plain when he pours out his Spirit in the last days. When he brings forth a new covenant, not after the covenant that he made with the father, our fathers, Israel, but a new covenant where he becomes our God, we become his people, we walk in all of his commandments and keep all of his statutes and do all of his decrees, all of his wishes, all of his divine order is fulfilled in our life. Because it's a new heart, takes away the stony heart, the insensitive heart that cannot understand or relate to the Holy Spirit or the things of God. Man walked out of the realms of the spiritual into darkness through self-interest and sin. He walked out from the realms of being able to see the reality of the ages, the eternal realm. But God stepped in to man's darkness and said, come on in, you must be born again. You must be born again. You must be born again. I'll allow you to become a new creature. I'll give you a new heart. I'll take your stony heart away. I'll give you a new spirit. I'll put my spirit in you. I'll make you one with me. This is what the Lord says. The Lord says, Jesus, Almighty God, the eternal Word, made flesh, stands up and says, come live with me. This is John 15. Come live with me. Come dwell with me. An invitation to all humanity. Those who sat in darkness, whom gross darkness covered their eyes and blinded them from the reality of who God is and who they are in God's plan, in God's purposes. Those who sat in the under the shadow of death, light sprang up. But men love darkness rather than light because they love sin. They don't want to make, the Pharisees wanted to be made kind of right. They didn't want to be made fully right. They wanted to be made right enough to be able to fit in, but they didn't want to be made right enough to have complete transformation, complete transfiguration. Redemption comes to you and me and offers us the privilege of complete transformation, of complete regeneration. To be regened. Men try to regene part of man's physiology, biochemistry. When there's some kind of a disease, they try to regene some parts of them through stem cell, what we call totipotent cells that can differentiate into whatever proteoglycans impose upon them, whatever proteoglycans are. You know what they are? Nobody else does either, do they? I'm not going to get into that. The knowledge of men's pills, you know. And Father steps in and he says, where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Do you understand how that the light is parted and the east wind is produced? Job's going, what? And now he's just talking about some natural phenomenon to Joe. He shuts him down. And then he says to Nicodemus, do you understand how the wind blows, where it's going, where it comes from? Do you understand where it's traveling to and where it's been? And now he's starting to say, look, he's not going to hold him responsible for understanding the movings of the Holy Ghost because he can't understand that. But he's going to hold him responsible for natural things which he can perceive out of a natural understanding. But even natural things that he can perceive out of his natural understanding, he don't get it. Now the Lord's going to try to talk to him about heavenly things. And he tells him, until you are born of the water and of the Spirit, until the new creation emerges, until that new thing that is completely regenerated by the miraculous power of God. You know, I hear all these different definitions about salvation. I love the definitions that Jesus gave. I love the definitions that Paul gave. I love the definitions that Peter gave. I'm not really interested in the definition that Origen gave, or Eusebius gave, or Augustine gave, or Luther gave, or Calvin gave, or your favorite preacher. I'm not interested. What did the Lord say about his definition of salvation? What does it look like? I love Paul's, for example, in Titus chapter 3, verse 5. He said, we're saved by the washing of the water of regeneration. This morning, I got the soap out. And I see that every one of you did as well, and I'm so thankful. Praise God. It smells pleasant in here. Amen. Because everybody got the soap out. And it cleaned off the things that were just basically residues from since the last shower, which basically, you know, doesn't take long to develop. And by the way, let me say this. You know, we're in the last stretch of the 21-day fast. Praise God for everybody who stuck with it. I mean, we're moving into the 16th day now. We've moved into the 16th day. It will be ended. We'll go into the 21st day this Friday. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
It's wonderful, though, to discover meat that the natural realm knows not of and drink that is drink indeed. It's wonderful. Fasting is a wonderful thing. Changes everything about your life and the dynamics of your life. Allows you to be more part of what's going on in the realms of the spiritual. Somebody said, I'm not very spiritual. Well, you better get very spiritual. And say, oh, I'm not very spiritual, means that you disqualify in the context of covet the spiritual. God's commanded us to covet the spiritual.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
You know what? Everything that belongs to him and who he is, to set Father before me and be on my right hand so that I should not be moved, is impossible until I'm born of the Spirit, because of the natural mind and the natural man can make no connection with the realms of the spiritual. The logizimo, or the logics or rational thinking of man's mind, can make no connection with who God is and what he's pleased with and what he's doing. But God would make us like a master helmsman who takes and moves a great and very large ship through the midst of the sea, through its currents, a great ship, and steers it by a small helm. Father will teach us how to move everywhere God the Holy Ghost moves, to move with him so that we can be led by the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
To walk in the Spirit, to live by the Spirit. Can you imagine? What's that like? A couple hundred years ago, they didn't have weather reports. They wouldn't know. The other day it was raining, and I was moving. I said, I command the rain to cease, and it will stay. It will not rain again. It will stay ceased. Somebody said, well, the weather report said it was already going to be good weather. As far as I knew, the Lord answered my prayer. Because I woke up, it stopped, stars came out. Somebody said, your timing was good. How do you know? The Lord didn't know I was going to say, I command the rain to stop. I'm moving my stuff right now. No. What happens when we begin to get a oneness with God, a unity with God, where condemnation no longer exists? Where shame no longer exists, where sense of sin no longer exists, where we're one together with him, we're like a branch and a vine. Did you know that the branch cannot exist without the vine? That the vine cannot exist without the branch? Did you know that you and I are going to be the representatives of Jesus Christ in this earth, or he's going to have none? And that our representation should be the display of the full gospel, the epistles of Christ, yes, written by God, yes, the finger of God. Watch out. When God calls you, you good things are going to happen. When he points at you, better things are going to happen. You must be born again. Somebody said, oh, that is narrow-minded. I mean, these guys, you think you're exclusive, and then everybody's got to do it your way. You know, that is as ridiculous as saying it takes a man and a woman to have a baby. I'll say it again. That is as ridiculous as saying it takes a man and a woman to have a baby, because I'm going to tell you right now, there's only one way to be born again and made a new creation. You're not good enough. I was talking to an accountant from a big clinical firm here in San Diego. He was on an airplane with me. You know, and I started talking about things of the Spirit, and, you know, he can't relate to any of them because he's, you know, he doesn't understand. He can't relate to any of them. But God, the Holy Ghost, will begin to deal with his heart and see whether or not he wants to relate to them. And, you know, and he's just talking about, oh, well, I'm honest and I'm good to people. I'm kind to people. I do my best to do what's right. Of course, he's doing what's right in his own eyes. I said, yeah, I said, the reality of it is, though, you're blinded by a spirit of humanism. He said, well, what's humanism? I said, are you ready? He said, yeah, I am. I said, you're not good enough for God. And he got offended. That's humanism. You're not good enough. Why ain't I good enough? Because God's holy, holy, holy. He's pure, full of life, full of love. And he's not changing. He's never going to have any hate. He's never going to have any strife. He's never going to have any envy. He's never going to have any unrighteousness. He's the author of life and every good thing. He's the author of covenant. He's not breaking covenant all the time. Today I like you. Tomorrow I hate you. I'm going to go to this church so long as it feels good. And as soon as it don't feel good anymore, I'm going to go to another church and be a contamination over there. Humanism says, ah, that's not true. I'm it. I'm the best. No, you're not, Nicodemus. You're not. You may be the ruler of the Jews. You may be the teacher extraordinaire. You may have been the one that everybody came to understand what you have to do to come into the kingdom of God. And I'm letting you know right at the get-go, you do not have a clue what you're talking about. This is Jesus. I'm breaking John 3:2 down for you, okay? Because, I mean, a lot of people would have said, you know, here comes Nicodemus, everybody's persecuting Jesus. They're just down on him. I mean, just trashing him right, left, and center. Here comes a very influential man. This guy can open some doors for us, guys. Let's have some wisdom. Wisdom sometimes is code for don't tell the truth. Let's have some wisdom. This guy can open some doors for us. He's the ruler of the Jews. Rabbi, he's laying it on. Teacher, we know that you are sent. We know you are sent from God. You don't know nothing. We know that you sent from God, for no man could do these miracles. And this is what Jesus said. You don't know nothing. He could just hang on. That you do, unless God be with him. And he just stops right there and says, Nicodemus, I'm just so glad that you can see. You know, I know you're like a little birthday candle in a wind. And so I'm going to come around you and I'm going to protect you and I'm going to nurture what little bit of life is there. And I'm going to try not to offend you with anything that I've got to say. And I'm going to baby powder your pew so everything's really nice and comfortable in the meeting. And so nothing happens in the meeting that would possibly offend you or cause you not to come back. Jesus doesn't have a ministry like that. The rich man, another rich, great, great, greatly influential guy with great wealth. Good master. What must I do to inherit eternal life? Once again, be careful what you say. Jesus, like, here it is. Go sell everything that you've got. Why? Because the man's heart was wrapped up in his riches. He had no idea that if he would have stayed around just a little bit later, longer, he would have found out that if he would go and sow everything that he has and get rid of all of his self-reliance and all the things that he holds his security and value in, that God would give him far more than he ever had. He didn't stay around long enough to hear that part of the message. Did you know that?
Yeah.
Did you know that after Jesus offended the rich man, he's good at that, after he offended the rich man, because he's, what is he doing? He's confronting humanism. He's confronting self-reliance. He's confronting what we think we know and what we think we understand. No man knows anything as he ought to. But think about it. And God wants to drive this home to you this morning. The way you think is all wrong. You need to shut that down. God's giving you powerful weapons to shut it down so you can walk and think like the Holy Spirit thinks. So you can think like Jesus Christ, so you can have the mind of Christ. So you can think like God thinks as we read his thoughts in the book we call the Bible. His thoughts. You get to John chapter 3, I believe it's, is it verse 10? I think it's verse 10 or is it verse 11? After Jesus breaks this all down and says you cannot know or see, you cannot enter into the realms of the kingdom, you cannot understand the workings of the Holy Spirit, which he equates to moving into the realms of the kingdom, to entering into the kingdom. Let me stop there again. Somebody said, are you saying the kingdom of God's already here? The kingdom of God will physically come one day in the future. But the kingdom of God is here. Jesus said in Matthew 12, 28, he says, if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God and work miracles, then the kingdom has come to you. Yes. He told all of his disciples to go preach the kingdom. Cast out devils, open up the eyes of the blind, command the deaf, to hear, the crippled to walk. When all of a sudden that becomes our inheritance, that becomes the riches which we possess. Things with the dynamics of what you will tolerate and the dynamics of what you will believe God would have you do can entirely change. I was in Nepal ministering one time, and it's just a radical youth, radical group of Presbyterians, Methodists, Nazarenes, Assemblies of God, Foursquare, just almost every denomination was there. And the youth of the different Bible schools. We taught them on faith and the evidence and the proof and the vital reality that God the Holy Ghost is in your life. And these people got so built up after I'd sent a friend of mine in. He ministered to them for right at about a week. I came in and ministered a couple of days. And they got so radical by the time the crusade was going on. There was tens of thousands of people there, multitudes and multitudes of people. A stadium that holds, you know, somewhere between 35 and 45,000 people was pretty much filled. And they were going and grabbing people out of the wheelchair and dragging them around. Knees being scratched up by the dirt and whatnot. Pastoral instinct started to say, don't do that. Just wait. And the Lord said, leave them alone. Raw, radical faith. This is what God has commanded us to do. We're going to do it. They heard it like for the first time. This is our identity. This is what God's commanded us to do. And it wasn't long and those people that they were dragging around were up running around. Pretty radical, very radical miracles. Suddenly we move past the limitations of our mind. It says, no, you can't do that. No, we prayed and nothing happened. Well, what if you have prevailing prayer? What if all of a sudden your eyes are open and you see that the answer is right there? I can see the answer right there. I know of a man of God who went into a hospital room to pray for someone who was dying. This is pretty radical, about having your eyes open to be able to enter into the realms of the kingdom of God, to participate with what the kingdom of God is doing. It's not just the event, the glorious event, the most wonderful miracle of all, salvation. It's every dimension of the life and ministry of Jesus. People want to have different, they want to dichotomize the life and ministry of Jesus. They want to have little portions of the life and ministry of Jesus. They just want to say, oh, we're just all human beings. No, you're not, you're a spirit man. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is a human being is a human being. But that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. You're a spirit. God is spirit. You're a spirit, Dale. Why is it that we don't want to be spirit anymore? Why is it that we don't want to be spirit to start with? Why is it that we want to be flesh? Why is it that we want to be human beings? When God said, when Jesus addresses, what does it really mean to be born again? To take on a whole new identity, to have your eyes open so that mind-blinding spirits don't hide the gospel from you anymore, that you don't live out your life subjected to the powers of darkness or the forces of hell. Live your existence as a mere human being. People talk about the human condition, and they want to explain away sin, doubt, unbelief, and all the rest of the mess based on the human condition as though it's okay now. No, it's not okay. Jesus is the door. He's the doorway. Door into what? Doorway into what?
Heaven. Life. The life of God.
Jesus came to give us the life of God. To give us his life. The life of the Spirit. That's what it means to be born again. To step out of the realms of being dead. To possess Jesus. He that hath the Son has life. To have him. To possess him. That he is in you and with you. Yes. He dwells and exists in you. Yes. And he reproduces himself in our lives by the miracle of the new birth. Yes. Because until you're born again, you cannot know God. Yes. You're dead in your trespasses and sin. The sin of Adam fell upon all men under condemnation. The obedience of Christ Jesus has now been made an available opportunity to everyone. Hallelujah. so that we can step into the life of God. You cannot live your life and be a human being in this realm and be right with God. We live His life. I am crucified with Christ. I am. It's not some unique situation for the Apostle Paul. It is the Christian creed. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. I live. I live. Because you can't wrap your head around being dead. People are trying to be dead. I'm trying to die. I'm dying. Get over it. Get over it. So that you can have yourself a resurrection. Because there's no resurrection until somebody dies. Are you listening to me? Yeah. Are you listening to me? I am buried. I am crucified with Christ. I am buried with Him by baptism into His death. I am raised up together with Christ. I am alive in Him. I am seated in the heavenly realm. Oh, that my eyes were open to the reality that I'm seated in a heavenly realm. That He is King of kings, that He is Lord of lords, that He's God Almighty, that nothing moves unless He says it's okay. That He allows it, that He gives permission. No temptation even confronts me unless He allows it. He's examined and weighed out and tried my life and my situation and the dynamics of my will before Him and will not allow me to be tempted beyond what I'm able and always will make a way of escape and brings me to a place of continually maturing me and perfecting me to a place where it doesn't matter what comes at me. I'll say no to Satan, no to treason, and yes to God. You gotta, you never even, you can't even begin. Can't even begin until you're born again. Because religion could never attain it. The righteousness of the law could never produce it. God had a problem with the first covenant. He found a fault with it. And He brought forth something that is forever and it's eternal and it's forever settled and He has no fault with it. And it's without blemish, it's perfect. And all those events were just to bring us to Jesus. Do you know what men had to do? What men proved in the first 1,567 years of men's existence in allegiance with Satan? In 1,567 years, men became so vile and so wicked and so corrupted in their ways. God repented that He made men. It never entered into His imagination that men could become so vile. So wicked, the thoughts of their heart were evil only continually. See, look, look. Somebody says, why does God allow sin to exist to save you? So that over the course of time, He could reach in and save you if you're willing to be saved. Why does God allow sin to exist? Why didn't He do away with it? He will. It's on His timetable. He will. And you better not be caught up in it. Because the world and the lust thereof shall pass away, but only those who do the will of the Father shall abide forever. You better find out what the will of the Father is. Jesus is describing it right here. Must be born again. Must be made a new creation. Become a possessor of the divine nature. That's the way Peter put it. Peter did it in such a radical way, didn't he? 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. He said, God, according to His divine power. That's a lot of power.
Yeah.
Divine power? Universe. Check it out. It's eternal. It's infinite. There's no envelope out there that that will reveal the initial event or the Big Bang. It doesn't exist. All theories of men. The more they polish the lens, the more they increase the sensitivity of the photo multiplier tube, they'll reach out further and further into space and discover, we should have already found the event. We should have already found the envelope of the Big Bang. And it's still not there. And they'll never find it. I was talking to an astrophysicist not too long ago. I said, so when will you guys have the equipment to be able to see the initial event? He said, in about 5 years. That was a year ago. I said, just remember, you heard it here. You can come back for more information later. When you think you're going to see it, it's not there. How do you know? Because creation reveals His eternal glory and Godhead. His eternalness. Hallelujah. It ain't there. Bad theory. It's eternal. He's eternal in the heavens. Peter says, God, according to His divine power, has given us everything that we need
People say, oh, God understands we're living in this world and all of our problems and issues. No, no, no. According to his divine power, he's given us everything that we need for godliness and for virtue. Amen. For life and godliness. He's given us everything that we need for his life, to do his life, not man's life, not a demonic life, not an earthly life, his life. The life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and show unto you that eternal life. This is John. That eternal life. The life was manifested, and we've seen and bear witness, and now I can show you that eternal life. Listen to John. He was radical. He was really saved. He really believed what God did for him. Listen to him. We want to make him a special person, a unique person that none of us can ever have, and we got to somehow, through our own efforts, attain unto that state. No, it's a gift to you. It's a gift to John. It's a gift to one and for all. There is no difference. There is no distinction. Scythian or Jew. That is a radical comparison. The Scythians are the most wicked, vile, and murderous people that lived in the days of Paul. From the Scythian to the Jew, he made no difference. Wow. You mean he's given to us the privilege and the ability to manifest the life? For the life was manifested, and we've seen and bear witness and show unto you that eternal life. 1 John 1:3, which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. This is where Jesus is personified as eternal life. We make eternal life, you know, a quantity of time that begins after we die. No, no, no. We now know that we have eternal life. We know that eternal life abides in us. Over and again, I can give you verse of scripture after verse of scripture. How many hours would you like to stay? The whole Bible generated right towards one point, generating one specific message that God created us his image and his likeness, and in oneness, in purity with him, and that he purposed to redeem us back unto himself and make a peculiar people that are zealous for good works. He said, I've given you everything that pertains to life and godliness because I've called you to function in my glory and in my virtue. And this is how he describes salvation. Now listen, is this salvation? Are you with me?
Yes.
Are you with me?
Yes.
Are you with me? This is what born again means.
Yes.
This is the faith. This is the faith. Now seeing that we have escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Huh?
Amen.
Listen to the faith. Listen to the faith. We have been made partakers of the divine nature. People hear that and they go, what? Somebody said to me, now I know that you're in error. I said, well, me and Peter both. Because I just quote what he said. I don't agree with you. Well, the reality of it is you're going to have to find some pinhole somewhere, because all I'm doing is giving you verses of scripture. You're going to have to try to find some place to slide in your error knife somewhere, because it's going to be difficult. I'm sorry. Forgive me, please. That you haven't been taught the Word of God, but it's been mingled with Christian tradition and philosophy to spoil you after traditions of men and not after God and not after Christ. Huh? God has called you and I to be conformed to the image. He's predestinated you and I to walk in the Spirit and to live in the Spirit. When you're born again, when you made a new creation, you get a wellspring of eternal life springing up on the side of you. It's an artesian. Don't ever stop. You don't ever get thirsty again. This is what he tells a woman who's been married 5 times, who's living with a man who's not her husband, an adulteress. And when back in the 2,000 years ago, if you was an adulterer, you get away with anything. But an adulteress, she was blamed for it all. Adulteress. Adulterer. It's a man's world. Stone the women. Here's Jesus. Here's Jesus. Just recognize who I am. He's dealing with her better than he dealt with Nicodemus. Nicodemus got himself some revelation, but she's the first to get this revelation. He didn't even give this revelation to the disciples. They're still clueless. What are you talking to her about? He said, just recognize who I am. And recognize the gift that I have for you. And it will be the life of God springing up. The life of God. See, God's life is eternal life. That's why we call it eternal life. That's his life. It's not just a quantity of time. It's a quality of life. Life in godliness for glory and virtue. And he defines that, giving all diligence to making your calling and election sure. Add unto your faith. Add unto your virtue faith, and your virtue knowledge, and the knowledge temperance, self-control, to self-control, brotherly kindness, godliness. Do you hear this? Yeah. Because we're just like, wow, I got the life now. I got the genuine life. I've got the pure life of God. I've got the realm of the blessed kind of living. I'm empowered to walk all day happy. I get to be happy all day. You've got to be insane not to want to be happy all day. Give me one valid reason to be sad, miserable. One valid reason, just a valid reason why you want to be sad and miserable for at least 5 minutes. And people aren't 5 minutes, 5 hours, not even 5 hours, all day long. Give me one valid reason to be sad and miserable. No life. No life of the Spirit. The fruits of the Spirit are absolutely essential. They are the vital signs of the Holy Ghost. See if you check my vital signs here. Huh? Peering in my eyes and what does it say? Get the clinician to make sure all my vital signs are looking right. The vital signs of the Holy Ghost. People want to live without the vital signs of the Holy Ghost and say, oh, well, I believe. The devils believe and they tremble. You need to get to shaking. You need to get in cooperation with God's word. There needs to be the evidence of the reality of a supernatural work of divine grace. Because when the wind of the Spirit blows on you, when the power of God touches you, something lights up. Something lights up.
Yeah.
Something lights up. Change comes. The change. The ministry of katalege, or reconciliation. Change. I'm a minister of change. My change that I'm ministering to you is not incremental. It's radical and instantaneous. It's that which the power of God does because of the authority of the only begotten Son who bore our sins in his own body on the tree so that we now can be cut off from sin and live unto righteousness by whose wound I was healed. My. I'm raised up together with him. I'm alive together with him. I'm seated in the heavenly realm. I'm in the heavenly realm. I've transcended the earthly. I transcended through a translation. Being translated. Somebody said, do you believe in translation? Yes, I believe I can be translated. It already happened. First time's already happened to me. Colossians 1:13. You've been translated. Yes. Been translated? Yes. Anybody here been translated?
Into the kingdom.
Yes. Amen.
Yeah, you have. You just don't know it. You are translated out of the kingdom of this world, out of the kingdom, the reign, where the spirit of darkness, the prince of the power of the air, the God of this world, imposes his tyrannical reign on humanity. You were translated out of that into the kingdom of dear son. I got translated.
Amen. Yes, thank you.
I'm going with Paul. I'm not going with Augustine. I know some of you have been hearing Augustine quoted so much. You're going, it's like the person said, I was quoting, you know, Peter. I know you never know. No. Sir, you've been listening to the wrong person. Somebody said, oh, we're unrighteous. We're all unrighteous. I said, what? You need to believe unto righteousness. For with the heart, man believes into righteousness. Amen. You want to be saved, you need to start believing unto some righteousness over here. The confession of your mouth needs to change. For with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. With the heart, man believes into righteousness. And that is absolutely inseparably connected with the salvific work of Christ Jesus, the saving work of Jesus, which he brought to pass when God raised him from the dead. Amen. It is absolutely 100% connected with confessing that Jesus was raised from the dead. Believing that resurrection resulted in your inward resurrection, where now you believe unto righteousness. Yeah. Yeah. Hallelujah. The gift. Do you know who I am? Jesus said to the Samaritan, do you know who I am? If you recognize who I am. She doesn't know anything. He's got to talk to Nicodemus the way he did, because Nicodemus thinks he knows everything and he knows nothing. The woman, she knows nothing. What are you doing talking to me? You're a Jew. I'm a Gentile. I'm a Samaritan. What are you even talking to me? Just recognize who I am, the gift, and you will have a wellspring springing up on inside of you. springing up, eternal life springing up. Do you demand of yourself a wellspring every day? Is it just always there, of joy?
Yes.
To where that you say, wait a minute, I'm not going to be sad. I got a wellspring to be glad. Wait. I'm not going to walk in hate and strife. Wait. I got a wellspring of love. I'm not going to allow men to impose upon me a character, an attitude. I'm not going to be vexed with all the spiritual state of humanity. I have a wellspring.
Yes.
I'm not going to walk in worry and condemnation. I got peace like a river.
Yes.
I mean, we sing it, right? We do it good singing it. I got peace like a river. And then all day long, you might have been living in a drop of it. There's times, you know, you just want to stop. Stop, everybody. Stop singing. Interrupt them. Everybody's all upset because they're all feeling the anointing and everything. Does anybody in here really believe what you're saying right now? Then the whole is as though the anointing completely goes out of the room. The anointing didn't go out of the room. False peace did. The anointing actually just came. Because God, the Holy Ghost, will always come with truth. No matter how radical or how offensive or how different it is from what you already believe. He's just going to. And we should be all happy about that because we should want to be corrected so we can do it God's way and have His results and walk in His blessings and walk in His glory and walk in His life where there is no death, where there is no sorrow. Hallelujah. True. It's true. Nicodemus says in John chapter 3, is it verse 10 or is it verse 11? How can these things be?
Verse 9.
How, thank you. How can these things be? His whole world is turned upside down. Because Jesus has just now told him that the only way that he can enter into the realms of eternal life, into the realms of the kingdom of God, to know God, to interact with God, to understand, to have an encounter with God, is to be born of the Spirit. Today I'm asking you, have you been born of the Spirit? Have you been begotten of God? Do you see yourself as a new creature? Do you see yourself as living out your life in the very life of God, having been filled with the life of God? Do you see yourself as one who is the temple of the Holy Ghost where there is a wellspring springing up? I don't know if you've ever read much about the temple that is going to exist during the millennial reign, but there's a unique feature to the temple that is going to exist in the millennial reign of Christ, that there's no man can create it on Mount Moriah right now or on Temple Mount right now. That is that there's a spring that's going to flow from right underneath the altar. Hallelujah. It's going to flow right from underneath the altar and it's going to flow right out the door. And it's going to go and it's going to water the whole territory. Now it's going to be even more unique. The temple that will exist after the eternal perfect earth, after the 1,000 years of reign of Christ Jesus, and God's going to, after the end of that, He's going to make a new heaven and new earth. That temple, which will only be, there won't be any temple there, a physical building, because God will be the temple.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Now, that's what most people understand in many respects as the kingdom of God. Fine. I'm in it now. I'm sorry you can't see. I pray that your eyes will be open.
Yes.
God will give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you can see.
Yes.
I'm in it now.
Yes.
I'm in it now. We're in it now.
Yes.
Get in it. And miracles will start happening pretty easy.
Amen.
Get in it.
Amen.
Get in it.
Amen.
Prophecy will flow. Visitations, dreams, and vision. The Bible will not be some kind of a metaphorical, you know, spiritual simile of something that's not reality. It become a living description of the experiences that you're having. That we get to see in Revelation chapter, is it 21? Yeah. There's a river. There's a crystal, pure fountain, flowing out from the temple of the Lord, from the presence of the Lord, from the throne room, from His throne. Can you believe that that's happening in you right now? Can you believe that out of your belly, as the scripture says, shall flow rivers of living water. This spake he of the Holy Ghost, which was not yet given, for he was not yet glorified. But having been glorified, having been exalted and received the promise of the Father, Peter said, you see, you both hear and see. Yes. This wonderful working miracle that he was describing. Acts 2:33 and 34. I want you to make a shift. I want you to get out of humanism, the human condition, and be in a human being. And I want you to be born of the Spirit, to be Spirit, to walk in the Spirit, to live by the Spirit, to be led by the Spirit. Which is the same, to walk in heaven, to live in heaven, to be led by heaven. Because it's a heavenly realm. God the Holy Ghost only brings a heavenly realm. When you encounter him, you encounter heaven. When you encounter Jesus, you encounter heaven. When you encounter his ministers, like me, you encounter heaven. I'm believing, God, that you're going to encounter more heaven.
Yes, Lord.
I'm going to tell you right now, there's a lot of people who encountered heaven in Jesus' life and thought they were having a demonic experience. It's true. He cast out devils by the devil, by Beelzebub, the prince of devils, the worst one, the Lord of flies. He hath a demon spirit. That's what they would say about him. They didn't realize they were encountering heaven. Their belief system locked them down to where all they could do is, at best, say, how can these things be? How can you bring death? How can you bring a non-relevant condition to all that my whole life is vested in and say that Judaism and mitzvah and all that I hold so dearly. Can you imagine? Here they are. They're in the temple. Here they are in the temple. Okay. Oh God. Oh Lord. Oh day spring from on high. When will you come and visit us? Oh well spring. When will you pour out your spirit as you promised? When will we draw water from the well of salvation, oh God? When will you lead forth your people in joy and in peace as you promised of old by the prophets? Divoting in the temple. Meanwhile, right behind them, God Almighty in the flesh is walking by going, you must be born again. We do the same thing. God the Holy Ghost is here and he wants to train us to let him have full control, but we're uncomfortable with it. Give me my hymn book. If you don't sing out of this hymn book, it is a proof that you are of the wrong spirit. I suggest we turn to page 319 and sing How Great Thou Art. Give me a hymn book and I recognize that you are legalistic. And the letter kills, but the spirit brings life. Where's the overhead? And there's some particular songs that I want to sing from the overhead so I can feel the anointing when we sing it. There's one, like just one song, I really feel the anointing. It's completely falsehoods. Complete falsehoods. It's what we become comfortable with in our culture. It's not God's culture. God wants the anointing to fall upon us and a divine inspiration and motivation to come out of us when we prophesy. Every time the Spirit, everybody, it ever came on anyone in the Old Testament, when the Spirit came upon them, they prophesied. They began to declare these wondrous and glorious things. Amen. Of who God is and what he's purposed. And it was true fire from heaven. Father wants a true worshiper. Yes. A true worshiper brought an offering, an expectation to have an encounter with Almighty God. When the offering was right and the heart was right, the fire fell. The encounter came. Why do we change it? And then act like we didn't change nothing. Why do we parse out God's word and make some of it for first century church and some of it for this church now? I tell you, the church is an unbreakable chain of the glory of the person of Jesus Christ. Existing and living in the midst of this world right now. so that the light of the kingdom of his and the light of his glory may be able to shine through you and me. It's the fullness of him that filleth all things. Why won't we let go of all of our little substitutes? All the little things that we treasure, that we feel comfortable with, that we supposedly feel the anointing. And every time I get to verse 2, I start crying. Nonsense. Emotionalism. Let God the Holy Ghost fill you with divine emotions.
Amen.
Whew, holy emotions.
Amen.
You won't even need a song to start moving and flowing in the genuine glory of the realms of heaven. Hallelujah. Why can't we just go and do it like it happened as the model sets forth the precedence in Acts chapter 2 and verse 4? And they were all assembled waiting. And there came the day that the church was born. The church was born in a rushing wind and clothed in tongues of fire. Why is it that we want something different? There's ample reason and evidence to believe that all the first century church services started with everybody speaking in tongues, having Pentecost. And out of that, the church meeting went on. Because that's the precedence. And all you got all the guys, 120 that were there. This is the way it works. Church of Corinth. Where did the church of Corinth learn all their bad habits? Paul, he's the one who started that church. He just stepped in and said, guys, come on now. Listen, it's got to excel. That's all he was saying. It's got to excel. You can't just have one big flow of dastiki, and everybody doing it together. There's some people in here don't know nothing. They don't know anything. They just came from sacrificing to the goddess Diana, walked, stumbled in here, and all they're hearing is, let it excel. Let it excel into an interpretation of the tongue. Let it excel into prophecy. Let it excel into miracles. Let it excel into gifts of healing. Let it excel into the demonstration of the ministry of Jesus.
Yes.
Oh, well, I'm a follower of Jesus. Oh, good. Do a miracle for me. Oh, well, that's a foul spirit. One in proof, one in sign. That's what Paul said. He said, I hear what you're saying. I'm going to come see you do a miracle for me. Somebody said, where does that say that in the Bible? 2 Corinthians. Said, I heard your boasting talk. I'm going to come see your power. That's how King James translated it. And some of the other diluted translations of the past 100 years made it even worse. So I'm going to come see your miracle power. I'm just going to see the miracle working of God. I'm going to see a proof of you. If you can't work a miracle, shut up. Vital signs of the Holy Ghost. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. People, if we would just start longing for it, it would be ours instead of being threatened by it. Why are so many people threatened by what God has commanded? Why doesn't it produce hunger in our heart to say, I'm laying hold on that. I want that. Greater works. I'm going for greater works. A Presbyterian preacher, Jonathan Goldforth, he read that one day and he goes, John chapter Princeton, a Princeton alumni, he reads John 14:12. These works, anyone who believes, these works that I do, shall he do also. He needs his papa. I'm sorry, I didn't get to that quick enough. Our new prophet in training. You can't really understand what he's saying right now. Just wah, a little bit of discomfort. Doesn't know, understand divine order, but he's going to get it, I promise you. Thank you, Father. What was I saying? Jonathan, go for it. He reads John 14. Thank you, baby. You're amazing, honey. Everybody else is looking at me with a blank stare. They're like, what do you mean? You talked about 15 different things. What are you talking about now? Same Holy Ghost. I'm going to get you somewhere. We're going to get you somewhere. I promise you. He reads, anyone who believes, anyone, this is me, should do these works and greater works than these. He said, I haven't even done these works. He starts earnestly seeking God. He was no longer threatened by what God commanded. You know God told you to be holy just like he's holy?
Yes.
Are you threatened by that?
No.
I'm not threatened. I'm empowered. I'm like, woo! I get to be holy because is God Almighty.
Yes.
He's the all-powerful one, the El Shaddai, the one who speaks and decrees a thing and it comes to pass and is established forever. Nothing can change it. And he watches over me to establish me and to keep me. And he's told me this is who I am and what I'm to be. And in that decree, he empowers. God empowers. He does this to be righteous even as he's righteous. Are you righteous even as he's righteous? Are you threatened by it?
No.
I'm empowered by it. I'm like, woo! It's like he said, I'll give you life. I'm going, I'm not threatened by him telling me he's giving me life. I'm going, yeah! Are you threatened by the fact that he says, I've washed all your sins away? Are you threatened by that? Are you empowered by it? People, we got to start looking at the Word of God the way it is. I'm telling you, this is friendly fire. This is God who loves us. This is a God who spared not his own son, but offered him up for the sins of us all. How shall he not also by him freely give us all these things? All these things. All these things. To be, look, to be pure, even as he's pure.
There's
no problem. They have rivers of living water pouring out of you. Rivers, I have rivers of the expression of God busted out of me. I'm like a little garden hose, trickle, trickle. And the water pressure's down. If we all had that, I'm going to tell you right now, if the church was like that, we'd say, we are in a full-blown revival. This is a great awakening. And it's just a little water garden hose with, you know, 10 PSI of pressure. Could you imagine what it would look like if we all assembled in the place and we had like those big old fire hoses? That'd knock somebody down. You got to have two guys to hang on to that thing. Huh? And we're still not there. We're still not there. We're still not there. We're not where he wants us to be. He set the bar really high. And he says, if you touch it, if you move it, then you've added to my word and you've taken away from it. You move it, it's another gospel. He set the bar really high. Because he in his great love and affection for us, does not want us to be anything less than he paid for us to be by the blood of his only begotten son. And we got to quit being threatened by what he's willed and just lay hold on it. Take a firm grip on his life, a firm grip on eternal life. I got a firm grip on Christ Jesus. He's standing looking at me right now. He's standing looking at me right now, just like he looked at Stephen. Stephen's being threatened and stoned. He's looking. I got myself a champion. I got myself someone who will stand for me even unto death. You need to start seeing yourself there. You need to quit seeing yourself separated and distant and far off and aloof and trying to somehow please God. Because I'm telling you, this gift gives you at the first moment the very righteousness of God to where you could never be more righteous in all of eternity. Never. Instantaneously, the new birth gives you the righteousness of God. And you could never be more righteous. It's a gift. He gives us this righteousness that we may grow and learn righteousness. Gives us his holiness that we may learn and grow and develop in all of his holiness. It's a miracle state of divine grace where even his mercy and his obedience abounds unto many offenses. He's there to wash us and forgive us and cleanse us and help us and support us, because God Almighty is our keeper. God Almighty has begun this work and he shall finish it. God Almighty has begun this wonderful thing in us by the Spirit, and we are made perfect by the same Spirit.
Yes.
What's your identity? Who are you? What do you believe about yourself? Are you going to start living the life of the Spirit? Are you going to start living in a wellspring, in a flow of divine power and glory? Are you going to start walking in the Spirit, living in the Spirit? Are you going to accept what he's done for you? Are you going to believe in your heart unto righteousness? Are you going to go ahead and lay hold on all that he has commissioned us to be as heirs, as his heirs, as his heirs? Are you going to covet the spiritual? Are you going to earnestly desire to prophesy? You want the fire of heaven to fall on you? Do you want your tongue to be lit on fire of hell? Or do you want your tongue to be lit on fire with tongues of fire from the Holy Ghost? You want to learn how to walk in self-control because you until your tongue can speak words that are right. Until your heart disposition, the atmosphere of your attitudes changes. Instead of feeling some threatened thing by or imposing thing or demonic thing, you're just like empowered by the Holy Ghost. You must be born again. And when you're born again, it's all about entering into the kingdom, encountering the kingdom, seeing the kingdom. The natural man cannot receive these things because they're foolishness to him. But you and I have been born in the Spirit so we can understand what eyes not seen, ears not heard. We can see it, hear it, move with him. And it's glorious. You're not going to want to go back to your trash can. You're not going to want to go back to your poverty-stricken life because you got the true riches. Today, God petitions you and asks you, would you like to be born again? Would you like the gift? The gift of his life filling you and flooding out of you. The gift of being made a new creation where you're the temple of the living God. Where God lives in you and walks in you and moves in you. Where you speak his word and think his thoughts and live out this abundant life. Everybody, would you stand with me? And I know this morning that there are many of you, you've been born again. You called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you were saved. Somebody said, what does it mean to be saved? And I hear people say all the time, oh, it means to be delivered from your sins. That's fine, but it means something more than that. To be saved, to be washed with the water of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost. Have you been washed with the water of regeneration and received the renewing of the Holy Ghost? Have you received everything that belongs to his life and godliness? Have you received the divine nature? Are you a new creation wherein old things have passed away and behold, everything is now new? Are you willing to believe that? Have you believed unto righteousness? Do you believe that you've received the righteousness of God? He became your sin sacrifice so that you may be made the righteousness of God in him. Have you received the gift of holiness so that you are holy just like he's holy? So that you can come by the blood of Jesus Christ through a new and living way into the holies of holies and stand before the living God, holy and acceptable. Are you still lower than a worm's belly? Are you still lower than the slime on the worm's belly? Crawling around unworthy of anything. Listen, come on, God extended his gift towards us.
Amen.
And worthy or unworthy has nothing to do with it. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. Hear how the Lord Jesus summates, you must be born again. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe should not perish, but have the life of God, have eternal life. Become spirit. Spiritual being. One with the Spirit of the Lord. He who is joined in the Lord is one spirit. Jesus said, Father, the glory that you've given to me, I have given it to them, that they may be one even as we are one. As you are in me, O Lord, I in them, and they in us. Oh, thank you, Jesus, for this unspeakable gift, for this so great of salvation. Father, we pray today in this building, right now, that every person in this place will allow you to give them your love, your mercy, your grace, that they will receive a cleansing, being totally washed in the blood of the Lamb, that they will receive an empowerment by the Holy Spirit to have authority over all the powers of darkness, to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy, to live this life, to live as light shining in the midst of a perverse and crooked world, to live out this glory of heaven. Oh God, I pray in the name of Jesus, every yoke be broken now, every hindrance be removed, that every person standing in here would simply believe who you are. You are the Redeemer. You are the Savior. You are the God who loves us so. And receive the gift that you've given. I tell you, there is no redemption outside of Jesus Christ, because there's no way for a man to be born again and made a new creation that is not rigid and narrow-minded, as I said earlier, any more than to believe that it takes a man and a woman to have a baby. That is just the laws of life. That's just the way it is. There's not any other power that can make you a new creation. There's not another power ever, never in the history of men that declared what Jesus said to Nicodemus. Never in any religion, anywhere. That belongs only to the Father, where He instantaneously, by His mercy and grace, makes us one with Him, holy and acceptable. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I see people who think, well, you know, I believe that, but I'm just not good enough to have that. I still have this failing, and I still have this fault, and I still am tripped up by the demonic realm. I'm going to tell you something. You listen to me. The day that you become good enough for God is the day that you've begone beyond grace. The day that you become good enough for God and righteous enough for God and holy enough for God is the day that you've moved beyond grace. You come to Him and you receive what His mercy supplies, His righteousness. You'll never have that kind of righteousness. His holiness. And you call it done. And you let God perfect everything that concerns you. I've watched so many people not come to Jesus because they say, I'm not ready yet. You know, I still want to do things that I know God doesn't like. Or one day I'm going to, you know, I feel like I'm going to be done with this thing or that thing, and then I'm going to be ready for salvation. Then I'm going to be good enough. It's just a lie of Satan, whether you're lost or whether you're a person who's called upon the name of the Lord Jesus but still have doubt in your heart as to whether you're really a new creation, of whether or not you've really received the divine nature, whether or not you really have a wellspring springing and a river flowing, whether or not you really are the temple of the living God, whether or not you really like a branch in the vine, whether or not you are actually the recipient of all that the Word of God describes that He's made us. Oh, you are, if you will believe that Christ Jesus is who He says He is, and that He offers the salvation that He's described. If there's anybody that is doubting that, I want you to know, I want to break off those suggestions and those lies of demon spirits. If there's any preacher or any person telling you somehow that you're not right with God and trying to play God for you, you know, you need to break that off. You need to call upon the name of the Lord Jesus and let Him do His work in your life. And believe what He has to say above what everybody else says. Today, if you want this so great of salvation, if you want this change in your life, if you want your darkness to become day, if you want sorrow and sighing to flee away, today's your day. Right now. The power of God is present right now. You can call upon the name of the Lord where you're standing right now here in this building. where you're listening to me, either on the web or by YouTube. Doesn't matter if you're sitting, standing up. Doesn't matter where you're at. All you do is call upon his name. In a sincere and true heart, he is absolutely God. Amen. He is absolutely King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He will absolutely hear you when you cry. Amen. That name, the name of Jesus, grabs the attention of the entire universe. When it's uttered, even by a small child. Thank you, Jesus. Anyone in this place here today, you know God the Holy Spirit's dealing with your heart right now. You know that you want, you know you need to get right. And you want to be right. You're done with the life that you've been living. And you want to start living God's life. He invites you to come. We'll pray with you and for you. We'll do whatever it takes to see Father settle it in your heart. And you'll be, he'll give you the same salvation he's given me. He'll give you the same salvation he gave Peter and John. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Paul, same one. Anyone in this place. Father, I ask you right now in the name of Jesus Christ, your only begotten Son, to allow the power of your mercy to begin to fill every person's heart by the supernatural working of the Holy Spirit. I break the power of every mind-blinding spirit in Jesus' name. Every condemning voice, every voice of a lie, so that each person in this place right now can begin to hear the voice, the sound of the Holy Ghost, the voice of the Spirit. I command condemnation to leave. Hallelujah. Because justification has come. Hallelujah. I command sin and iniquity to depart, because righteousness and life has come. The blood of Jesus Christ has washed it all away. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Well, praise God. Father, he loves you so much. Tonight we're going to have a meeting. We'll be meeting here, just believing God to do supernatural signs and wonders and miraculous things, which is what he does in his church. At 6 o'clock, meeting for prayer is at 5. There's a Wednesday night service this week, 7 o'clock. You want to be in all the meetings, because church is the kingdom of God right now being revealed in a unique way on the earth. You want to be a part of the company of saints. You cannot have church in your living room. Anybody who tells you you can have church in your living room is a liar and part of the father of it. You cannot have church in your living room. The church is something that Jesus Christ did. There's an apostle in it. There's prophets in it. He described what it looks like. The foundation of the church and the community of the church. Gifts are there. It's resident. It's that which he's standing in the midst of. Hallelujah. It's the assembly of the saints. So don't let anybody deceive you. Can't have church in your living room. Somebody said, what if I'm watching a television program? Fine, watch it. But it's not church in your living room. Oh, but I'm watching a church service in my living room. Get in church. If you are up somewhere in the boondocks of Montana and it's 12 foot of snowdrift, and you're listening to me right now, I can understand. And we will believe an extension for church in your living room. But if there is a church where you can go to, and the Assemblies of the Saints, just because you don't necessarily, whatever it is, with your opinion, have high marks for that church, why don't you go there so full of the Holy Ghost and see revival come? And, you know, go there, getting on your knees praying, oh God, these people are blinded, oh God, they're rejecting you. Go there and you love them. You lay your life down for them. That's how redemption comes to people. Hallelujah. You know, have any of you heard of Pray and Hide? Pray and Hide shook India. He's one of the early missionaries to India. They called him Pray and Hide because that's all he did, is pray. prayed revival. He cried out for God to give him the nation of India. God's still answering his prayers today. But we call him Pray and Hide. Great men of faith and power. If you've never read about Pray and Hide, you need to. Wow. What a great example of faith. What a man. A man who laid his life down and gave his entire life for a nation. One day he went to this meeting, and it was like a, you know, congregational Anglican church in India. And the preacher was just dry as last year's shucks. And shucks are, you know, what you peel off the corn. And he just was dry, and he didn't look like he had anything going on in the spirit. And he went home, and he started to pray for this preacher, and he says, oh God, this preacher, he's just so dry and barren of the reality of your presence. And as he's praying, trying to, you know, intercede for this guy so this guy could have a move of God in his life, the Spirit of the Lord said, quit talking about my servant. That comes by way of an honest and a true report from a great man of God. Something that everybody needs to take heed to. We've got all of our opinions and all of our charges, but none can lay any charge against God's elect, for he is justified. We can, if we're filled with the Spirit and walking in the glory of heaven, we can help, huh? We can help participate in leading people into a glorious move of the Spirit of the Lord in the right kinds of ways. Amen. Well, I just love being with the saints of God. Listen, I just want to say again, I thank you, every one of you, for continuing to celebrate New Year's with us in this 21-day fast. And I promise you, you're never going to be the same. I promise you. And I pray that you'll really learn how to give yourself to fasting and prayer. Because it's beautiful. It's a wonderful realm. Somebody can talk about all that they want about fasting and prayer. Some people do. Now, everybody's got all these religious things. It's, you know, it's amazing how religion and religious things are thrown around. Everybody's religious. They're religious about not being religious. And it just gets crazy. But every person you know of, you can think of them right now, that was used in any way on a grand scale by the Spirit of the Lord, I promise you, many of them I know personally, lived with them, many of them, they touched heaven through fasting and prayer. I promise you. It doesn't matter whether they're talking about jumping around in the shower or trying to get wet. Fast so much. I promise you. I know how their life began. I know how they laid hold on God. So you'll never be the same. I promise you, you'll never be the same. It's just a beautiful thing. So I want you to worship the Lord right now in a very unique way. And that is with worshiping the Lord with your tithe and with your offering. Somebody said, just try to stay with me. I know everybody starts moving around right now, but there's right way to move around and wrong way to move around. But every act of obedience creates a great miracle of faith. You have to understand me. The giving in tithe and offering in a New Testament perspective is a means by which we participate with the miracle of faith. Amen?
Amen?
The Lord said, if you sow a little, you'll reap a little. He's amazing. Everybody's reaping, little or much. Isn't that great?
Yeah.
I mean, man was said, if you sow a little, you're not getting anything. The Lord said, you sow a little, you're still going to reap. That's a multiplication.
Amen.
It's a miracle. And so we want every one of you to participate in a miracle, not so that you can have a bigger house, finer car, more clothing, but so that you can participate in a greater way with seeing the orphans taken care of, the widows taken care of, the nations of the world evangelized. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. So I want you to do two things here in closing. I want you to worship the Lord in giving, because that's really fundamental to worship. And I want you to find everybody around you and hug them and tell them that you love them. And if you have a problem with hugging people and tell them that you love them, by the time you get to the fourth person, you will be delivered. I promise you. If you want to love people more, I promise you. It's
tell you by the Spirit of the Lord. By the time you get to the fourth person, you'll be delivered. So worship the Lord with your tithe and with your offering. Find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name.
You're amazing.
You're on.
If anyone wants prayer for anything, we're here to pray with you and for you. Healer's in the house. The Redeemer's in the house. The healer's in the house. The Savior's in the house. The miracle worker's in the house. Whatever you might have need of, he's the need supplier. It's come. Thank you.